All right, thank you very much to Professor Chen and dear professors, dear venerables, and dear young scholars. I'm very honored to be given this opportunity to speak on this year's theme, consensus and openness. But I do feel a little bit too junior to be delivering a so-called speech, both from the academia as well as the field of Dharma propagation. But nevertheless, I do welcome this opportunity to represent the younger Buddhist community so that we can speak and together to think about these very question of how we are able to provide a Buddhist response, especially in the era of globalization and information explosion, where we're faced with so much information and the work or the pace at which we need to think and to accomplish our tasks is at a much higher speed. And so how can Buddhism provide these responses to the issues of modern society as well as the needs of humanity? That's something which all of us here today as members or participants of the Buddhist Youth Forum need to think about. And yesterday when we had dinner with Venerable Jue Chen, she asked many of us who were present, and the question was, what do you think are the reasons we took this forum to Singapore? Why was it not held in Malaysia or Hong Kong or maybe Taiwan? Right? And so we thought about it, and some of the answers which we gave to her was, well, first of all, Singapore is the hub of Southeast Asia. Everyone comes here. Right, so the newest, the top people and the best things all gather here at Singapore. And the second answer was Singapore has the edges of being international, given the language edges, right, the open views and the different chances to meet and be exposed to the world. That's why we all have this forum in Singapore. Okay? And the third answer was that Singapore, especially the people that already have the mindset ready to reconnect with the values of humanistic Buddhism, which is the very core value of Fo Guangshan, the Buddhist community. Okay? And so we gave her all these answers, but at the end she says, my answer to why we hold this forum in Singapore is because we are here to discover the diamonds who may play a big part in the future of Buddhism in the 21st century, which is you, okay? Dear young diamonds. Okay? You're not here to find an answer from us, but we're here maybe to hear about what your answers may be. Okay? But nevertheless, today, as being said that we are still the younger Buddhist community, what I would like to do as a part of my keynote speech is to present some of the perspectives on openness and consensus spoken by the Venerable Master Xing Yun, who hasn't yet had a chance to publish his paper. So this is like a first glimpse to what he thinks of this year's theme. Okay? And so in terms of consensus, we need to think about what is actually in store for our future, for those who want to either study or practice the Dharma. And so the major thing here would be to establish a consensus on the importance of humanistic Buddhism for our future. Okay? We are now faced with the reality of division and differences among Buddhists in the world. And if those of different traditions and different practices don't share a common goal, and there will be no opportunity for us to even think of communicating or cooperating with each other on how to make this world a better place. And now, as some of us now turn towards the question of what that common goal is, many are believing that humanistic Buddhism will be something that shall offer us an answer to what that consensus may be in the 21st century. And why humanistic Buddhism? Okay, let's go back to the Buddha himself. After attaining enlightenment, the Buddha taught the world that only by following the middle path and living a life that is free from the dualities of suffering and joy can one truly resolve the problems in life. And for this reason, he spent 49 years teaching at over 300 assemblies, all for the purpose of instructing, benefiting, and bringing joy to society. 释教立习. Consequently, the Buddha's compassion and teachings bequeathed the so-called Buddhism to the human world. And so one can say that Buddhism had been taught by the Buddha to the human world for the purpose of helping humans resolve their difficulties in life. Therefore, everything that the Buddha had ever taught serves the purpose of discovering happiness and peace in this world, which was the very first theme of the very first Buddhist Youth Forum on Humanistic Buddhism. And so that is why we can say Buddhism is in fact humanistic Buddhism. And even the original intent of Buddha's birth into this world and why he wanted to share his teachings. Everything he had taught is humanistic Buddhism, and everything about humanistic Buddhism is Buddhism itself. That is the type of consensus which we wish to establish at a forum like this. And since Buddhism embodies the spirit of humanistic Buddhism, and that everything about this idea is Buddhism itself, some of us may wonder then why bother adding the word humanistic into this term. And the inference behind this is the time span of 2,600 years that separated Buddha's time and ours. Along this considerable amount of time, various sects and reflections of Buddhism arose due to differences in opinion among Buddhist disciples regarding teachings and precepts. And so these disparities have added to the challenge of unity among Buddhists. For this reason, cooperation between Buddhists and the development of Buddhism have become rather difficult. Furthermore, after Buddhism spread to China, political oppressions and social changes impelled Buddhism into the mountain forest, causing it to become a religion that focused on spiritual cultivation in seclusion for the sole benefit of oneself. And this situation was worsened by monastics who spoke the Dharma solely from their own perspectives, exaggerating the need to be otherworldly, dismissing people's need in life for wealth, love, and family. For example, whenever we mention wealth, and monastics before would talk to you about how money is like a poisonous snake, right? Don't touch it, it will bite you, right? When you have money, you're in trouble, okay? And when speaking about marriage, they would say, oh, your wife and husband were your enemies from your past lives who have come back to make your life miserable in the present time. Okay? And so when talking about children, and they would say, oh, your children are your debtors who come back to collect debts from you, so you have to keep paying them back. Okay? And so the lack of value for human life in traditional Buddhism has strong criticism from society for being rather unhumanly and irrelevant to real life. And that is why we now propose humanistic Buddhism by holding true to the original intent of the Buddha so that we have a chance to again represent a lifetime of Buddha's teachings through a comprehensive view of why he taught it in the very beginning. It is hoped that through advocating humanistic Buddhism, we are able to grasp the true meaning of the core teachings of the Buddha and his spirit for liberating this world. Through the unification of different theories and opinions, we hope to reconnect Buddhism with the human world. Only then can we truly realize Buddha's original teachings today, and furthermore, to ensure a thorough understanding and practice of the Dharma so we can discover greater happiness and perfection of life. We believe that these are the very reason to why the Buddha spoke up in the beginning. So he chose to be born into this world and to teach the Dharma in this world. As Ephraim mentioned, humanistic Buddhism holds true to the Buddha's original intent. Because he was born in the world, he cultivated, attained enlightenment, and taught everything in the world. So if not humanistic Buddhism, so would it be better for us to call it rebirth Buddhism? Or how about animal Buddhism, right? For Buddha teaching the Dharma to dogs, any chance of seeing that? Or maybe when we focus on the disease, we could call it hell Buddhism, or Asura Buddhism, or maybe even hungry ghost Buddhism. So which do you think is better for us? Why are we here to discuss Buddhism? Obviously, it needs to be humanistic Buddhism, just to reaffirm the speech given by Professor Chen Jianhuang on the need and the connectedness of Buddhism to us, therefore humanistic. And so we can say that the Buddha taught Buddhism to human beings, and that's why everything we discuss about Buddhism would be the Buddha's humanistic qualities. So he was a human, not a god. And he was not a divine being who came in without a trace. Even if the deification of the Buddha were true, where we have the statue here, people bow and prostrate to the Buddha, we would say it is not consequent from people's pronounced admiration of him. Right? When you see somebody whom you really admire and love, you will throw yourself to the ground out of veneration, nothing more. And so we would say it is the result of his arduous journey of spiritual cultivation, his thorough enlightenment of the human mind, and the ways of human nature and character that led to the attainment of his virtue, character, compassion, and wisdom. The teachings expounded by him, such as dependent origination, the middle path, the three Dharma seals, or the four noble truths, and so on, they all are the supreme truths that reveal the path to mental and physical well-being. They show the means by which we liberate ourselves from life's predicaments and present solutions to life's problems, such as birth and death, as well as everyday living. Okay. Let us illustrate this in the instance of karmic retribution. So we would say karma denotes deeds or actions, and the fortunes and misfortunes that we experience all arise from our respective actions. Namely, it is our karma. And accordingly, when Buddhists pray to the Buddha, the wish to eradicate karma carries greater importance than the wish for good fortune. Provided that we practice the three acts of goodness, to do good deeds, speak good words, and think good thoughts, our minds will be filled with the power of integrity, and we shall inherently be relieved from adversity and calamity. We thereby accumulate merits whilst removing unwholesome karma. That is why we practice the three acts of goodness and the four givings, which are fundamental. And on the other hand, the four givings symbolize the four immeasurable states of mind, 四无量心. They are detailed as give others faith, give others joy, give others hope, and give others convenience. Being willing to give others faith, we will naturally speak comforting words. And in the willingness to give others joy, we will innately see the good in others and praise them. Essentially, this is what we mean by speaking good words, therefore purifying our verbal karma. Owing to the willingness to give others hope, we will instinctively show care, concern, and encouragement. In essence, it is good to think good thoughts. The purification of one's mental karma, befitting the willingness to give others convenience, one will naturally offer a helping hand altruistically. This is to do good deeds, and subsequently, the purification of our corporal karma. Thus, the three acts of goodness and the four givings both embody the four immeasurable states of mind cultivated by bodhisattvas. And collectively, these are the core concepts of humanistic Buddhism. Nonetheless, it is human nature to prefer gaining over giving due to our fear of loss and the disadvantage resulting from the acts of charity and virtuous deeds. For this reason, people regard virtuous deeds as difficult and fruitless practices. But the truth is, the act of giving is like sowing seeds. How can you harvest without sowing? How can there be crops if seedlings were never cultivated? How can flowers and fruits grow if seeds were never planted? And so within this notion of cause and effect, as well as karmic retribution, Buddhists stand resolute. As early as 5,000 years ago, Buddhists were already propagating this universal truth of the Buddha world. Therefore, we call it humanistic Buddhism. And so, therefore, what humanistic Buddhism advocates is neither blind faith nor unquestioning belief. Rather, humanistic Buddhism aims to inspire wisdom and rationality. Those willing to accept and practice this will be mindful of the wisdom of Dharma and its insights to the truths of life. By doing so, mental and physical well-being will not only be possible in our present life, but we will also free ourselves from the fear and sorrow caused by life and death. Ultimately, a consummate life will be attained. Moreover, we will not be the sole beneficiaries of our faith. Our descendants and future generations shall inherit our faith in the Dharma. Fittingly, we shall convey to our descendants the bountiful knowledge of Dharma. Their minds shall awaken to their Buddha nature. They will grasp the truth through the three Dharma seals. They will strengthen their faith in the Four Noble Truths. And with the five vehicles, all realms will be open to them. They shall contemplate the world of Buddhas through the gate of the six paramitas. The seven factors of enlightenment shall nurture their wisdom. And by adhering to the Noble Eightfold Path, they shall further their practices. In other words, humanistic Buddhism will open our eyes to a faith that is real, virtuous, and has true potential. This faith will empower us to find peace and stability, relieve us from the constraints of daily worries, and allow us to clearly perceive all phenomena through dependent origination and emptiness. Understanding the true meaning of emptiness can awaken our Buddha nature and true thusness. Therefore, this world does need humanistic Buddhism, as it can help all living beings realize a happy and peaceful life. And basically, we would say that what is humanistic Buddhism? It can be defined as what the Buddha taught, what is essential to human beings, and these both represent the essence of humanistic Buddhism. In this world, people cannot strive without the protection of their country and the supporting conditions of society. From the moment we are born, we become dependent on a material life, provided by the knowledges given by scholars, farmers, artisans, and merchants. A human being also has the need for family love, friendship, and kindness. And in order to elevate one's character, a spiritual and aesthetic life is necessary. Moreover, since the issues of life and death are unavoidable, we need to seek faith. So in light of this, whatever it is that we practice based on the guideline of humanistic Buddhism, there are certain principles. Remember, it's not us who solely benefit from this. Therefore, for anything that we do, may glory go to the Buddha, may success go to our community, may benefit go to society, and may merit go to devotees. And additionally, Venerable Master Xing Yun also proposed the following principal creeds of humanistic Buddhism. Whatever it is that we learn, understand, or practice, so our sole purpose is, first of all, to honor our family and country, to lead a moderate lifestyle, to value worldly interconnectedness, and to maintain a peaceful and joyful mind. And so as we abide by humanistic Buddhism, may we join our hands in propagating the teachings, restoring its ties to the Buddha Dharma. May the Buddha's compassion and wisdom shine light onto the universe and this world with brightness and hope. And for this, we hope that we can establish a consensus to hold true to the Buddha's original teaching and also stay true to the spirit of humanistic Buddhism. And lastly, I would like to use the remaining time to talk about openness from the perspective of young Buddhists or young scholars. We know that after the Cultural Revolution, China went through a period of poverty and deprivation, where the Chinese society remained behind and closed. But after Deng Xiaoping's policy to open up, the Chinese economy took off. And added with technological advancement, the speed at which China has changed was beyond our imagination. China has now become one of the leading and the most powerful countries in the world. And so from this, we can see openness leads to connection, and connection ensures improvement. And so the same goes to Buddhism. Buddhism has always been an open religion. It never held any other faith or religion as enemy or foe. We can see this in the Buddha's statement in the Diamond Sutra, where he says, of all kinds of sentient beings, whether born from an egg, womb, moisture, or transformation, whether beings are with or without form, whether they are with or without perception, I shall cause all of them to enter nirvana, thereby liberating them. And so we would say this altruistic and selflessness exhibited that by the Buddha is the very idea of openness. And so how do we remain open as young Buddhists? I have three basic suggestions. First of all, can we be open towards the interpretation of Dharma for our future? So based on what we have learned in the books and what we are seeing and practicing in real life, we are discovering many very creative ways for how the core values of Dharma can be presented. For example, in August, when I went to New York Deer Park, this American primary school teacher used a piece of paper to explain the concept of emptiness. First of all, she asked us, what does a cup look like to us? And so then she took out the yellow one and asked, is this what your cup looks like? Then she took out a glass and says, is this what your cup looks like? Right? And then she took out three other different cups, but none of them fitted the description that we had in our mind. And so she then went on to, if The appearance of a cup doesn't fit your imagination. Then let's talk about the function of a cup. What is the function of a cup? She says. Some of us told her the function of a cup is to be able to hold liquid. Okay. So she says, okay, if a cup is something that contains and holds liquid, she took out the piece of paper, folded it into a cup, poured water into it, drank it. She says, this is what emptiness means. You can be anything, but after that anything, you become nothing. And after she took a drink, she took the cup again and ripped the paper into pieces. She goes, there you go, there is your cup, right? So we remain open and creative towards our interpretation of the Dharma in order to ensure that the world can truly benefit from the wisdom of the Buddha. And secondly, how do we remain open as young Buddhists in terms of our mission? Okay? We all know that before we decide whether a country has a future or not, we look at how their youths are doing. So this applies the same to Buddhism. How the youths are doing today in Buddhism will determine the future. And so we need to be open towards the kind of missions and responsibilities that young Buddhists can take on now. It's no longer just about leading chanting sessions or meditation sessions. It's about you now taking a step forward to be open with your perspectives and to open yourself to the world to see what changes you can make with the inspirations of the Dharma. And so when I first reported to Venerable Master Xing Yun about coming to this youth forum, he said, yes, as young people, go out, fly into the world. Fly into the world, interact with the world, and accept the world as you see. And then you shall start to make a change to yourself and others. Therefore, we shall remain open. And last but not least, as we decide to become open, what are the approaches of Dharma propagation we can rethink as well? Okay, in the past, we've experienced the need to be both active and peaceful. So now, how do we be actively peaceful as young adults, right? Other than the practices of chanting, sutra calligraphy, as well as dialogues and meditation, there are also active movements for young Buddhists to find a way to bring the Dharma to the world. Okay, so we now see in Philippines, a group of young Catholics are singing, dancing, and performing the Buddha's story to the world. They're now reaching to more than 10,000 schools across the Philippines to tell the story of this great Buddhist. And in Brazil, we see a young group of boys who are learning the spirit of the three acts of goodness by being a part of a soccer team. And then we go to Taiwan, we see these many young people who are not Buddhist, but through being a part of the basketball team, as well as the baseball team, they are showing the Taiwanese society how education for a whole person character building can happen through the participation of sports under the guidance of the Dharma. And so these are only some of the examples to how we can open our world up as young Buddhists to make a change. And in the future, as the world comes closer together, when we are given even more priorities and privileges to expand our world and to grow, hopefully, under consensus and openness, we will come together to create a much better world and a much better future for Buddhism. So in closing, why are we holding this forum in Singapore? I hope you already have an answer now, but maybe that answer won't be proven correct until 3 or 5 years later. But I would say, keep writing, keep learning, keep exploring, and keep sharing your findings at the forum like this. And so maybe in 5 years' time, when you come back to look at yourself, you'll see how much you have grown. You see how much confidence you have in being able to play a part in this world as a young Buddhist. So all the best to all of you, and may we continue to work on this consensus and openness. Thank you very much.